Nice to be here, and thanks a lot for the organizers for this possibility. It's very special for me story because it's my first time when I'm doing a lecture on Zoom. Yeah, so I apologize if something is not as it should be possibly. It's not something which I used to anyway. Yeah? I'm used to have auditorium, people see them, and when I'm watching the screen, I have some very strange feeling, very unusual, I would say. So yeah,
we can always ask people to switch on the videos if you want to.
No, it's for me. It's okay. Whether switch on or out, yeah, it's irrelevant. So the talk is, yes, as already I was written here on the screen, probabilistic point of view on generalized fractional calculus and generalized operator valued Mittag-Leffler function. But I would say that I will not speak only about probabilistic point of view. In fact, one of my goals is really to unite probabilistic and analytic point of view. So those listeners who are not very strong in probability, I hope they also find something useful in this talk, because I really like to unite the several points of view on the thing. Yeah, but the idea is actually to introduce generalized fractional calculus in its somehow possibly most general possible way, and see how there are unified methods, both analytic and probabilistic, which allows us to solve the corresponding equation in rather straightforward, so to say, way. So my idea is actually to make the story simpler, even using generalized operators. So how I work with the screen? I don't know how to.
You just press. You see this? Well, your pages 1 to 80. So you press on the button. The to the right. Yeah.
No, yeah. It was share real quick. I just wanted to go up and down.
Oh, it's already. Yeah, it
doesn't work. I think it's not working.
Click there.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so thank you. Yeah, I had to click to something. Okay, now it's fine. Okay, so you see there are two pages here of abstracts, which I'm starting with, yeah? Abstract analytic and abstract probabilistic, yeah? So both points of view I'd like to present. Yeah, so first analytic point of view, how we can look at mixed generalized fractional derivatives. So you've seen already today, there was a very nice lecture of Professor Mishura, who explained you the main sort of operators fractional derivative, and I'll show them again you in a minute, yeah? But when you recall yourself, then what you see, you actually see that this derivative fractional is some weighted sum of these increments, yeah? From values of function f from the past to the present. Therefore, from this general point of view, what we can expect to have as a generalized mixed fractional derivative, we just take any weighted combination of these increments of all of the past, okay? So that's the analytic way to introduce generalized fractional derivative in their full, so to say, generalities. And also we can see directly also from here, what is this new? Well, new is some measure, which measure? Yeah, so should it be necessarily finite? Not necessarily. But what we want here, we want that this operator will be defined at least on some nice function. A nice function, a smooth function. So it should be defined on smooth function. Now you see this thing for small y, this thing is of order y. Yeah, therefore this measure new should integrate the function y. And as we'll see, this is analytic requirement. It coincides with the requirements of probability, where you can find that these are requirements on the Levy measure. So this is so-called derivative in the generator form, and the derivative of Caputo-Jobarchan or Riemann-Liouville, they are obtained just by restriction. Yeah, the most simple way of looking at this derivative is just by restricting this thing on sets of functions which are either constant on the left of some point A or zero. We will see this in detail later on. And the probabilistic abstract. So from the probabilistic point of view, if you look again at this generator of fractional derivative, so if you are probabilist, yeah, then you see that they are generators of Levy subordinators. And this Caputo, Jubarshan, and Riemann-Liouville derivative can be viewed as regularized assumptions, generators of stable Levy motions interrupted on crossing a boundary. Yeah, I will explain this in detail a bit later. So this interpretation naturally suggests fully mixed, two-sided, or even multidimensional generalization of this derivative, as well as probabilistic approach to the analysis of the related equation and the explicit construction of the solution in terms of past integrals, which are well amenable to numeric calculation. And as a result, as I mentioned already, we want to get here a universal method for solving quite a class of generalized fractional partial differential equations, actually included also classical partial differential equations. So plan here, three parts, and we'll see how much time I will use. Possibly will not come to the end of the story. We'll see how it will go with the time. So first part, I really would like to explain you the notion of generalized fractional derivative and generalized fractional integrals. The second part, we'll talk about operator-valued Mittag-Leffler function as a major tool for solving fractional linear ordinary differential equations, partial differential equations, and pseudo-differential equations. And finally, most general extension, as I say, I'm not sure whether we'll come to this point, we'll speak about two-sided and multidimensional extensions, and also about the case beta between one and two. So at this point, I would like to mention that all these first two parts will speak about mixed derivative of order not exceeding one. Yeah? So as I said, there are extensions outside of this domain, but if we'll have time, we'll be able to talk about them at the end of my talk. And what is left out of the talk, and which is very important story, these are nonlinear equations and also time varying generators. So that is something which remain outside, but still is very important. There's quite a lot of interesting things to be said about it. I gave here two slides of bibliography. So I put here just my bibliography. It does not mean that there is no contribution, of course. There's tremendous contribution. Therefore, because there's tremendous contribution of many authors, you know, this fractional derivatives is just they are flourishing and expanding with tremendous speed. Yeah, so impossible to mention seriously and to make any review of the bibliography. Therefore, I put here just main points, main papers on which the story I'm telling you is based. And in particular, I'd like to point out this paper, probabilistic point of view on the generalized fractional partial differential equations. This is a survey of mine, which has appeared in the previous year, Fractional Calculus and Applied Analysis. And this is open access paper, so everybody can read it. And mostly, in fact, my present talk is based on this paper. And secondly, I would like to mention my recent book, Differential Equations on Measures and Functional Space. There is a whole chapter devoted to fractional calculus. And again, many things which I'm talking here are here, included in particular those two topics which are omitted from my talk. Okay, so part one, generalized fractional derivatives and integrals. Just one general comment before I start is that there are many approaches. In fact, this is not a new topic. And there are classical books, for example, of Virginia Kiriakova, Generalized Fractional Calculus, the books of previous century even. So there were two, I would say, two approaches to this generalized thing, yeah? One is to try to, you know, all these fractional derivatives, their solutions, they're connected with some special functions. So in looking how we can extend the special functions, yeah, we can obtain some special classes of fractional integrals and derivative. And that was, I suppose, the initial approach to fractional calculus, which is finally and nicely explained and reviewed in the book of Virginia Kiriakova. And the second is to look at fractional integrals as just integral operators. Yeah, I can say, well, this is integral operator. So as a mixed fractional integral, let's consider just arbitrary integral operator with some kernel. Yeah, so that's another way. But with this approach, the link with derivative is a bit sort of not clear. Yeah, so my approach is different, really. I'm starting not from generalizing fractional integrals, but from generalizing fractional derivatives. And then we define integrals just as inverse operation. Okay, so I'll start with recalling you, well, the formulas which mostly I suppose were given already today on the lecture of Mishura. So this is Riemann-Liouville and CD. Well, I say this, you know, Caputo-Jabarchand derivative. Usually it is referred to as Caputo derivative, and people are used to this, but nevertheless, one should say that the book of Jabarchand appeared at the same time when the paper of Caputo, so they are possibly both words being put here together. And also to be more or less possibly even more fair, they are both not worse of it. Because as I actually learned recently, looking myself through the historic paper, that the Caputo derivative was in fact written by the same Liouville who have written Riemann-Liouville derivative. So it's just Liouville derivative number two, yeah. But to distinguish, now we can call them Caputo-Jabarchand fractional derivative. And the difference is of course, sort of, of course, one is related to another. And if you start looking at one of them, it's very natural to look at the second one. So you see, this is a formula which we obtain if we apply iteratively the usual operator of integration. So n time integrates. And this formula can be easily obtained by the integration by parts. And from this formula, again, you see how to extend it to non-integer n, okay? So everything here can be, instead of n, we just write beta, yeah? And what can we see from here? That factorial is a gamma function, so we write gamma function. So this is Riemann-Liouville fractional integral. Now, how can we define the derivative? I don't know, can I here write something? I don't see my, no, I don't think I can. Where is the
you can add comments.
Yeah, comments. Where they are, I cannot see them. Because it is the usual place when they are closed by
tools, probably.
Here they are. Mm-hmm. Here they are.
Oh. And then if you want, you can take the pen and just circle something if you want.
Yeah, so I wanted to draw this to show how we can define the derivative, you know, the integral. You see, integral is going upstairs, yeah, by some number, and derivative is going downstairs. Now imagine you know how to going downstairs by one, usual derivative. But upstairs we can go for arbitrary real numbers. You see, so if we want to go some piece down less than one, then we can go a bit up so that we'll have one here and then go one down. So what I'm saying that in order to go on beta down, we can go one minus beta upstairs and then one down. And then therefore that's the way to define the derivative. Yeah, so derivative of order beta, so here I'm writing for arbitrary n, but in fact, let's talk about just one. Yeah, we'll go one minus beta integral up, and then derivative one down. And here is naturally, we can do it in a two ways. So first integral up and then derivative down, or first derivative down, integral up. And this gives us two ways of defining this fractional derivative. One is Riemann-Liouville, and another is Caputo-Jabarchand, yeah? So in Riemann-Liouville, we're first going upstairs and then downstairs, and in Caputo-Jabarchand, we first go on downstairs and then upstairs. So you see, this Riemann-Liouville was more sort of natural derivative historically, just because it seems more natural first to do regularization. We first do beta operation, integration, and then differentiation, rather than first take the single operation. So though it looks more natural, but in fact, from many point of view, Caputo-Jabarchand derivative is much more natural from many point of view, as we will see later on. But both of them, you know, have their rights. Okay, so now in order to go to the direction which I want to go, we have to rewrite these definitions. And this rewriting, yeah, these are not obvious kind of thing, but there is now complicated. You should just apply the definition to perform couple of integration by parts, and that's what you can get. So this is just equivalent rewritings of the formulas which were written previously in this first integrate, then differentiate. So these are the form which is somehow convenient and natural for those kind of differentiation, which I'm, and generalization, which I'm going to speak about. So in particular, if we look now, take A minus infinity here, yeah, then all this, both the things turn to this one form, which is called fractional derivative or the beta in generator form. Sometimes it's also called Marshall derivative. There are some other names here. So that's what is usually denoted d beta by dx beta. Yeah? And we in fact see that if I is minus infinity, then these terms gives us the same. So in this case, Riemann-Liouville and Caputa derivative, they do coincide. Now, this is the main probabilistic link, yeah, if we want to look at the probability, the link which I mentioned already. If we take minus this derivative, yeah, then this operator, any probabilist would recognize this as the generator of a Levy stable subordinator. As I mentioned already, those of you, if there are listeners who are not very well familiar with probability, then just, you know, skip a bit my words about probability, because I will speak both about probabilistic link and analytical as well. Yeah. So in analytical way, we'll see again how to generalize it. Yeah. Just instead of this weight, take some other way. Yeah. And we'll get generalized derivative, which we are going to talk about. Now, next slide here, I put additionally, yeah, it's very general slide, not to do actually anything with the mostly with the topic of this talk, but this is central slide for people trying to understand the link between probability and analysis. So it's very crucial place here, yeah? And of course, specialists know this very well, and sorry if I spent their time, but for novice, possibly it's very worth stressing, yeah? So this slide shows us these three languages, how they come up together. Probability, functional analysis in terms of semigroups, and partial differential and pseudo-differential equation. If we consider Markov process, when this x, xt means that Markov process starts at point x at time t, and we are interested in the expectation of some function of this process, then this can be obtained by applying the e in power tl. So this is semigroup generated by operator L. So this L is then called the generator of Markov process. So this is the mean, the basic link, yeah? Or in other way, so this is probability and semigroup theory. Now here is probability and pseudo-differential equation, yeah? So from here we can derive directly that Ft, this function at time t, satisfy this partial differential equation or pseudo-differential equation depending on the form of L. Yeah, so this is basically Markov processes, operator semigroup, partial differential equations. So possibly, so historically, I think the starting point for this is the seminal paper of Einstein, 1905, where this link was recognized to the Brownian motion. And then this expanded, and I say, well, this is really one of the really central point for the whole stuff, analysis probability. Now, again, some comment about this thing. Yeah, so this is semigroup generated by operator L. If L is bounded operator, then this exponent can be understood just as a series usual. But if it's not bounded, then there is functional calculus. So here's analysis, which allows us to define the semigroup. Not very sort of obvious procedure. Now, of course, this link is not for all operator L, not all operator L define Markov semigroup. And in fact, L should be of the famous Levy-Hinchin form. And if they are, then they do generate this Markov processes. So it's like another one of the pearl, I would say, of probability theory, the full description of those operator L for which this semigroup defined as the processes. Okay, so this is particular case. So this is the generator, and so this generator that corresponds the process, yeah, x, xt, such that the expectation can be found via the semigroup or via the solution of this equation. Well, just one word about right derivative, but possibly really not worth much spending time on it. So we look from an integral, you know, from a to x up, though this is from a to x down, more or less the same thing. So these are right derivative. So the only subtle point here that we naturally get here minus one in power n. So if we want to extend it to complex n, then there is some subtlety, yeah, because this is not well-defined function. And therefore one can do it in several ways. One can take some main branch, but then it's not, again, not a fully defined function. Or simply one can ignore this complexity and write minuses. Some also doing it. This is sometimes simpler and not to bother much with complex numbers, which really has nothing to do with this integral. So some detail, not very important. And to this also the correspond right derivative. Again, you see they're just corresponding to moving sort of forward. Yeah. So instead of usual derivative fraction, which consider the past, they are responsible. They're responsible for the past, for the memory of the process. Yeah. This right derivative, they are responsible for the future. They are forward. So in some sense, they are much less natural. And as they are, therefore, they are much less in use. Now, main observation. Yeah? So let us look specifically at the decreasing process generated by this A. Now we want to see how from this generator form we can obtain this Caputo or Riemann-Liouville derivative. Let us modify now the process X. So the picture is the following. Our process, yeah, possibly again was saying a couple of words here, that this process generated by this thing also, let me use a couple of sentences here again for not for the specialist in analysis, but for somehow novices. Yeah. So this memory and how, in principle, the process can be thought. So say, how can it be imagined? How can it be read of from the form of the generator? This generator means that processes they jump occasionally on some point, so from some point X, yeah, they will jump to the left on the distance Z. And these things define you the intensity of jump. So in principle, this generator is reads of, it explains the following process. Staying at some point X, we will jump in, on the Z left with this intensity. Now here is another subtlety: intensity is infinity. Yeah? So intensity is infinite. So effectively, if we have a bit cut off here, epsilon, yeah, then there will be really normal intensity and we'll get normal kind of Markov chain. This is a limiting thing, but anyway, picture is the same. So it's jumping, jumping, jumping to the left with this kind of generalized intensity. Okay, so now we want to modify the process in order to see what is the process which is responsible for Caputo-Jabarshan on Riemann-Liouville derivative. So you see we're here, we have here this point A. Okay, and now process of is jumps, 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 jumps. But at the point if it wants to jump over A, it is caught up here and put to A. So this is the process which is obtained, which is responsible for or corresponds to the Caputo-Jabarshan derivative. Remember, Caputo-Jabarshan, it differs from generator form because it has this boundary point A. So in generator form, we have this process with jumping infinitely to the end. For the Caputo-Jabarshan derivative, we'll get the process which is caught here. And once it caught here, it stays there for the rest of the time. And if we're looking at the Riemann-Liouville derivative from the probabilistic point of view, it tells us that we're jumping, 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 but when we attempt to cross the boundary, we're not stopped here, but we just killed here. So Riemann-Liouville derivative is obtained from the generator form by killing a process on the attempt to cross the boundary. And Caputo-Jabarshan derivative defines you the process which is stopped on the attempt to cross the boundary. That's it. So therefore, that's the way to define Caputo-Jabarshan on Riemann-Liouville derivative from any basically generator of an arbitrary Markov process, which we will speak about later. So this is key observation. And this means that we can If we, in fact, rewrite this thing, what is meant? Now, I want to show here. What is meant here? So this is how long can we jump? You see, if we cannot jump more than A, then all this X minus Z become just A. So if we make now integration, because these things doesn't depend on Z, yeah? Then we can get explicit expression, and we see that really we get this Caputo derivative via this procedure of stopping and jumping on the attempt to cross the boundary. Okay, so that's the conclusion. If we are interested in the transition from the free derivative, so to say, in generator form, to Caputo left derivative at A, yeah? So this is a particular case of the procedure of interrupting, decreasing now process. It jumps only to the left and the attempt to cross the boundary. And that's the way how it looks like, yeah? So instead of this thing, yeah? So that is the transition from the operator in generator form to the Caputo, to operator describing Caputo Jabarshan derivative. And similarly, we have the transition from this right derivative. So from the right derivative, now our process is jumping to the right. Jump, jump, jump. But when it's attempt to cross point A, then it is here stopped. Yeah? I usually introduce the, say that why actually, you know, this is very elementary kind of observation, but it was not stressed somehow in the literature. So I have drawn the attention to the community on this, to this point, and I actually say that it was very natural for me to discover this interpretation, because this is, what is this? Yeah, you have to check your passport on the attempt to cross the boundary between the countries. And this is, of course, very important to Russian peoples, much more than to other international people, yeah? So you see, this is general point. You can take arbitrary Markov process, yeah? With a, not, when you want to draw from the generator this Caputo Jabarshan version, yeah, you have to be stopped on the boundary, and then your passport should be checked, yeah? And of course, Riemann-Liouville version is much harder. Your not passport is checked, you are just shot them down, yeah? Can happen. Okay, so conclusion, as I already mentioned, we can take this arbitrary operator. In fact, we can imagine jumps up and down. This really corresponds to both right and left derivative put together, or in other way, it refers to two-sided problem. So in this two-sided problem, again, the same story. We just, whenever we, so we are now have some kind of interval, yeah, A, B, yeah, and so, to get two-sided derivative, Caputo, Jabarshan, or Riemann-Liouville, yeah? When you are jumping here around, then you are jumping. Once you attempt to cross either this boundary or this, you are stopped or killed, yeah? If you stop, this is Caputo, Jabarshan derivative. If you are killed, this is Riemann-Liouville derivative. So this slide actually is a sort of introduction to part three, to which I don't know whether we'll have time or not to talk, yeah? Now we almost return to one-sided derivative back. So now we'll speak about generalized fractional integrals. Yeah, we discussed with you generalized derivative, yeah? I summarize generalized fractional derivative. This is just weighted time, weighted sum of the increments of the values of the function from the past, analytical point of view, and probabilistic point of view, they are generators of decreasing Levy processes. Now, what are integrals? So we know the integrals, yeah? They are, of course, inverse operators to derivative, yeah? So this integral I beta minus infinity, so minus infinity means that the integration starts from minus infinity. This operator is identical operator on function with compact support. Yeah, so in the language of semigroup, this operator, fractional integral starting minus infinity, is the potential operator of the semigroup generated by this operator. And potential operator is inverse to the generator, or it can be better described as the limit of the resolvent. Yeah? So this is resolvent, this is lambda minus minus, yeah, the thing in power minus one. So limit when lambda tends to zero, this is it's just the inverse of the operator itself. Yeah, why it is usually written in this way and not just the inverse? Because resolvent is well defined for positive lambda, and when lambda tends to zero, this operator may be or may be not well defined. Yeah, so in this case, this operator are well defined, so potential operators really are well defined, and they describe this fractional integral. Now, if we want the integral starting from some other point a rather than minus infinity, then easy, we just have to reduce this operator to the space of function which are zero at the left of a. Yeah, I'm writing here kill, again kill on the left of a. Yeah? So therefore generalized fractional integral, if we are interested in sort of generalized expression, so this is just in the, now we're talking on the level of operator semigroup, on the language of operator semigroup. I have the fractional derivative generalized. What is the fractional integral? This is a potential operator of the semigroup generated by the process and reduced to the space of function, which are zero to the left of A. Easy. Now, probabilistic language, and again, so this requires certain probabilistic maturity. Yeah, this is important. Yeah, but this a bit kind of for insiders. Yeah, so usual fraction integral solves this differential equation, of course, as we know, as it's designed to. And here we can recall that the Feller processes, yeah, for any Feller processes with generator L, this function is a martingale called Dynkin-Martingale. And from here we derive the formula for this potential operator, this IBA, in this form, in the form of path integral now, yeah? So this is the expectation over all passes of this process jumping to the left, yeah? And tau x is the time, you remember this picture we started here, we're jumping, 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 and at some point we reach this boundary A. So this is tau x is the time when this decreasing process starting from x reaches this boundary point A. This gives us this integral, and this is a representation of the fractional, generalized fractional integral in terms of path integral or probabilistically. And therefore, so this is some kind of remark for usual fractional derivative beta. And the same will be now for other defined by this mu. Remember, mu is this mixing measure, yeah? This is just again the expectation of the decreasing gravity process generated by this operator stopped at the attempt to cross the boundary. A very simple formula. You see, I'm saying simpler, yeah? Because if you look at these remarkable books of say Virginia Kiriakova, Paul always referred to her because some very basic classic, yeah, introduces generalized fractional integrals. They were introduced from the point of view of special functions, yeah. So for this integral, you will see three line or four line formulas expressed in some Cox function or H function. They are tremendously looking, yeah. Now all of these formulas, they're expressed in this one go. All, yeah, just put specific L here and you'll get this, yeah. So all this very complicated, and then something I will show you a bit later, how all this classical generalized fractional integral, Adamar fractional integral, Kiriakova-Luchko, RDI, Kober, Ra, Kahl, I suppose, all of them, yeah, they all sit in this one formula. And finally, we come to the language of differential equation, yeah? So here the main object is a fundamental solution. Now, if you remember, fundamental solution to an operator is kind of inverse, yeah? Fundamental solution is such solution of the equation, such that if we apply the operator to this function, then we get on the right, the Dirac delta function. And it is known that the fundamental solution for this operator has this specific form, yeah? Again, it's not a fully obvious fact, yeah, but this is so-called classical kind of thing. And therefore, it tells us what? That the usual fractional integral represents the integral operator with the kernel being the fundamental solution of this operator. Or in other words, the convolution with the fundamental solution restricted again to the space of function, which are zero to the left. Therefore, from the point of view of pseudo-differential equation, what is the generalized fractional integral? Generalized fractional integral is just the convolution with the fundamental solution of the operator from which we started with. That's it. That is the third language. And they are all the same. In fact, they are all defined using the same object. Yeah, probabilistic in terms of path integral, pseudo-differential equation language, fundamental solution, and semigroup language, potential operator. They're all the same. And now, in fact, you see, of course, I'm talking here a bit omitting details. One can, in fact, see that all these integrals are well-defined. You see a process well-defined. So everything here can be done. So for any L nu, and possibly I will return you back to this L nu. Even on the first slide it is here. So for any measure nu here, yeah, which is Levy measure, meaning that it integrates y, yeah, so it has singularity of not very strong singularity at zero, everything here works fine, yeah, and all these objects are defined, all these fractional integrals in all these three formulas, they in fact define the same thing. Now we can go even further with our generalization, yeah? This measure nu, remember it was just depending on y, but in fact the weights can also depend on the initial point, yeah? So this is fully general extension. So here we have the decreasing process already, not a Levy process, a Sfeller process. But anyway, with the same condition on nu. So this is analytical, which I called mixed derivative of order not increasing one. And we in fact even can add this order one, the derivative itself, yeah? Now we can in fact see that under this natural condition, well, I even here explain, particularly here we in fact already not so simple because we need some regularity with respect to X, which should be somehow carefully written. And I give you here the exact formulation, yeah? Then in this case, in fact, this process generates a Feller semigroup, so semigroup is well defined. It has invariant core. Invariant core is a subset of function which is invariant under the action of the semigroup, and on which we have really images. They really solve the equation. Remember the equation which I have written there. Semigroup, they solve the equation. Okay, so condition are the following: this gamma, yeah, should be C1. This gamma, this drift C1, and there should be the derivative of nu with respect to X defined again as a Levy measure. And also there are some technical technical bounds up. Let me not stop on this, but this told all these properties. This is about some kind of uniformity of the integrability of nu with respect to X, yeah? So let us not spend much time on it. Okay, so now we need potential measures. So potential measures, these are integral kernels of potential operators. You see, it was not even so fully obvious even for the Levy process, neither is it obvious for this case that the potential measures are defined. So in other words, that this inverse operator is well defined. So, but this is anyway the formula. Remember, potential measures they obtained from the resolvent. So this is the main formula for the resolvent of the operator. Resolvent, yeah, is lambda minus operator in inverse power. Possibly I draw here, no, lambda minus A. I'm not very good in drawing. So this is the resolvent of the operator A. And this TT is a semigroup generated by operator A. So this is a basic formula for the resolvent. Now this can be written in terms of the, in analytic language, this is fundamental solution, and probabilistic language, this is transition probability. And therefore we can rewrite it as an integral of some measure here. And this measure is lambda potential measure. So this is the kernel, integral kernel of the integral operator which express the resolving. Now potential operator is lambda to zero, so this is limit of the thing as lambda tends to zero. Now to do it properly, I mean to have all these bounds, yeah, because in principle you can say why this exists, why the limit exists. So the main here tool is the comparison principle. We compare our measure depending on X with some measure which does not depend on X. So if we have lower bound in terms of the measure which doesn't depend on X, then everything related to this will be bounded by everything related to this. I mean, everything is the same as potential operator, semigroup, everything really. Yeah? So for example, for any non-increasing function, we have the comparison principle for semigroup, the action of the semigroup TT defined by the operator with this measure depending on X is bounded by TT given by this. We have comparison principle for potential operator. Potential operator of this nu is bounded by the potential operator nu tilde. And with the potential operator of nu tilde, we have standard bounds. I'm not saying that this is obvious, but this is standard fact which gives you the upper bound for the potential operator of Levy processes. And finally, we have the same for lambda potential operator. So lambda potential means the kernels of the resolvent operator. So for them, we also have the same bound. And this means, and also if we have upper bound, then with the same will be all the bounds can be given in the opposite direction. So this means that with this bounds, everything is defined well, and we can define corresponding generalized fractional integrals. And again, this all these three ways, yeah? So this is in terms of semigroups as the integral with the potential kernel. Probabilistically, we can define it again as the expectation of the process. This is now decreasing process defined by this new tau x is again the time of exit of the process. So everything is the same. And also we can talk about the language of pseudo-differential equation, but not stressing this because in this case, just it's less well defined, less well used, I would say, the fundamental solution for this weighted thing. So now example, as I mentioned, there is tremendous amount of this generalized fractional integrals, yeah? And there are quite a lot of books and sources devoted to them, yeah? So I keep saying about the book of Virginia Koryakova, but it's not the only one source. There's quite a lot of even books devoted to the thing, yeah? And papers, yeah? Tremendous amount of them, yeah? There's quite a lot of variety. And even more, now it's very popular. You see now the people starting realizing how great is the science, and everybody now thinks that he invents some new integral. So we have integrals of any person, yeah? So add some epsilon here, subtract epsilon, and call it your own name, yeah? So we have lots of sites where they're just full of some names attached to whatever small generalization we can imagine. So all those generalizations, they're all sitting as elementary particular cases of the general theory I presented. And probabilistic, and even further, I would like to present you now analytic constructions, which gives you all of this operator again in one go, just get some specific functions substituted in particular spaces. So as I give you now these two, this is now not for probabilistic part, two simple analytic construction which allows you to define all known generalized integral and derivative in one go. So now if you remember where we started from, we started from the usual integral and started iterating it. So if we look at it from the completely sort of separated of everything point of view, what we can generalize if we want to generalize. So if you want to generalize, then instead of usual measure, you take some other measure. You take Stieltjes integral. So let's start from this integral, yeah? G, so G is any function of finite variation which defines you a measure. Start with this. We can do everything the same. We take iterated n times, we'll get this formula. From this formula, it is very natural to again extend it in the same way, beta here, gamma function here, and we have iterated integral, and we have generalized fractional integral. You see, so majority of generalized integrals are obtained from this formula. Instead of g, usually you have to use some power function. So Hadamard integral, for example, it obtained from this contraction is g. G is the derivative of gb, is 1 over u. So it will be Hadamard. With other power function, we'll get Erdei-Cobert, Kiriakov-Luchko, and other integrals. Now we can look at it also from another point of view, so second way of doing the same thing, yeah? We can just, instead of this way, we just make the just the change of variable in the integral, yeah? If g is strictly monotone and continuous, then writing this integral previous, if we just rewrite in terms of g, yeah, so this is a change of variable for the integral which was here above, yeah? We can just change the variable integration from u to g. So if you do it, then you'll get this formula. And so this suggests that a fractional Riemann-Liouville-Stieltjes integral can be obtained directly by the corresponding Riemann-Liouville integral just by the change of the variable. Yeah, so namely, we denote by omega the operator acting as the change of variable, and just dress the usual Riemann-Liouville integral in this thing, yeah, to obtain some generalized dressing operator. Now, once this idea of dressing is introduced, it's very natural to extend it by dressing with other simple operators, and other simple operator are operator of multiplication. Yeah, so take usual fractional integral, then dress it in the change of variable, then dress it in the operator of multiplication, concretely the formula. Okay, so remarkable thing, all known integrals, all fancy formula for three, four lines or whatever they ever written, they are all sitting in this thing, yeah, in this very simple one formula. And in the paper which I referred at the beginning, and I say this is the main paper mine from which I taken this this review, this really concretely explain, yeah, all this Hadamard, Erdei, Cobert, how they all fit in this scheme. So all this omega m, they are all written there explicitly, and the corresponding process are defined. Remember, now they all have their probabilistic versions, so they all correspond to certain processes. Okay, so this is again dressing, and well, as I say, all this Erdei, Cobert, they are obtained by this formula with function g, w, and v being power function. Okay, so another slide, and possibly there will be time for a break. So another slide, this is something which I consider an interesting point, but really not developed, but possibly somebody could be interested in this thing. Now, if we take what happens, it's very natural, of course, instead of this g, if we take something random, yeah? And what is the simplest random thing? This is standard Brownian motion. What we obtain if we're doing this thing, yeah? Can we iterate? And it's not at all easy. So it took me some time actually to calculate the thing. It's not at all obvious, yeah? Kind of remarkable formula. I don't know whether it's known or not actually, yeah? So if you iterate such integral with a deterministic function, or not in fact deterministic, it just should be smooth adapted process, then if you take k time, then you get this strange formula, and this is Hermit polynomial applied to the shifts of the Brownian motion. Okay, so from here it's natural how to define this fractional integral. Yeah, again, we'll you just have here extend, this will be again gamma function, and this here power k should be substituted by the corresponding fractional thing. So here we obtain somehow random fractional integral. I actually do not know anything about this thing. This is a kind of fractional Wiener integral, but these are not fractional Wiener integral, which are standard in the probabilistic theory, and it's not the fractional Wiener integral about which I suppose Professor Mershura will speak about. Okay, so possibly this is a good point to have a stop. Yes, so this is part one, and possibly we have some break under Elena control, yeah, for some question, so, discussion, and then we'll continue.
Yeah, yeah. So thank you very much. It was extremely interesting. Yeah, and now is definitely the time for the question. So if you want to ask a question, just unmute yourself and ask the question. So any questions? Any questions? So if not, I would like to ask a question. So that's a fractional Brownian integral, yes? Stochastic integral. So that's minus one. So it's the same problem, yeah? Minus one power k here. So everything, yeah. So it's as the previous, the same, it will be the same solution as you explained previously. Or
well, you see, I don't, you can make complex thing here using the complex power of operators, yeah? This is one theory, and it is not unique. You see, these powers, they are not in a unique way defined. And the same way here, so you can make fractional here, and there is again not uniquely defined for complex number. So there is some non-unicity here, but as you say, yes, it's the same as say for right derivative. But I really do not know where it comes from, so whether it's useful or not. It's just very natural comes because from this general point of view, as I say, which contains everything known, yeah. Well, what this is, I say, is there something unknown? Well, possibly this is unknown, yeah. But whether it's useful or not, whether one can do with it, but formula is remarkable, actually, yeah.
Yeah,
as I say, it's not at all obvious, yeah. And you have to play quite a lot, you know, to find that, yeah. So it's not an obvious formula, but what to do with this further, yeah, I do not know. But it's interesting, possibly, project to investigate.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I know what will be the fractional derivative of the exponent. That will be a hypergeometric function.
So yeah. We'll
probably talk about it later. And also another comment. Do you think, well, you presented so nicely the different approaches, you know, the three languages. Do you think that another language can be added, the language of combinatorics? Because Levy processes, well, you know, I'm just thinking Levy processes and, well, they can be also, well, the umbral calculus can be used. So we will,
calculus?
Umbral calculus.
I do not know, sorry, what is umbral calculus?
Well, basically, well, to basically it's when instead of, moment generating function. Well, if you look at the moment generating function, yeah. You write it as a series that will be moments, and then you write it as an exponent of a series.
Ah, you take logarithm of the thing, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then you look at the cumulants, and then at the cumulants, like words of this cumulants, and then you use combinatorics to operate with it.
So I think this is a very nice project, you know, to, you know,
yeah.
To work out this link. Yeah, I have nothing to say about it, really.
I'm sure something should come out, and it's discrete, yeah? So that's very different.
Yeah, it's very different.
But in terms of convolutions, it will be. Yeah, well, the question is, what about using the Poisson process instead of Brownian emulsion?
Yes, you can see what happens. So there are all the possibilities. So, but you see, the point is that if you use Poisson process, or if you use more generally just anything with the function here, with which has this finite, finite variation, then it's somehow already included in the cases which I considered above. I consider the function here arbitrary function of finite variation. In particular, Poisson process, it will be random, yeah, but it will be exactly the same as previously. Yeah? So in order to get really something new as compared with the integrals considered previously, really you have to put here a function which is not a finite variation. Then you get something new, and in fact, then the formulas are different. Yeah, you will not get such thing for formulas with finite variation. Yeah? So that's the point. But of course, Poisson process, fine, yeah. Then you get integral of the previous slide, they will be just random.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, so thank you very much. I think we have 5 minutes just for rest, and then I will return in 5 minutes.
Okay.
I will put some nice music, probably.
No.
Yeah, so I would like to say, well, there are some questions. So the slides for this talk are already on the website. So you can download the slides from the website. Well, they're already attached near where the title of the talk by Vasily is. You will see the link called slides and you can download the slides for this talk. And the same will be for all the speakers. And Yulia's lectures, I think the first two parts are already also on the website. As far as I know, there will be 7 parts. So the first two are there and the 5 more will be uploaded later. Yeah. So there is no exercise session today, but I will send out the exercises and also upload it to the website. If you want to participate in the exercise sessions, which will start tomorrow, please email me and I will include you in that email list. Okay, well, thank you very much. So we continue.
Continue.
Yes, yes, please, yes.
Okay, so part 2. So what we discussed with you are starting from the fractional derivative the general framework, which allows us to consider mixed fractional derivative in rather a general setting and the corresponding integrals. Now, all these derivatives, they of course are interesting from the point of view of solving certain differential equation linked with this derivative. Yeah? So the starting point of the fractional calculus is a theory of ordinary fractional differential equations, which are obtained if we, from the usual ordinary differential equation on the left instead of the derivative, put some fractional derivative. Then we obtain the simplest ordinary differential fractional derivative. So how the theory proceeds? Well, this will be ordinary differential fraction, but we also consider partial differential equation fraction. If you consider, say, diffusion equation, and again on the left, instead of usual derivative, you put fractional derivative. And I'm pretty sure, again, in the course of Professor Mishura, this question will be discussed, and also in the additional lectures. So these are partial differential equations. We also can consider pseudo-differential equation fractional in the sense that we can consider, have on the right-hand side some pseudo-differential operator, for example, some Laplacian and some power, again, and on the left, again, fractional derivative in time. So there is a big collection of this equation now, and they, in fact, appear in various domain of physics, but this is kind of would be additional talk to talk about the application. I will just speak how the equation can be solved for this, solved in this generalized setting, which I explained. And I will speak only about linear equation. And as I mentioned already, unfortunately, the nonlinear are left out just because of the time frame which I have. And also final sort of this comment that the main player here from the analytical point of view is the Mittag-Leffler function, and in fact their extensions, which are obtained here. So this is the starting point. I don't know when it started. I don't know, possibly 100 years ago. Who first noted it? I don't know. Yeah. So if we write the simplest equation, linear equation with Caput-Jobarchand derivative on the left, here's just function f multiplied by some constant, and beta any basically positive number. And then the solution, and if you consider the Cauchy problem, so the value at a is given by some number y, then the solution will be given by this formula in terms of this remarkable e beta Mittag-Leffler function, which is defined via the series, which is very natural, of course, extension of the exponential series here. If alpha is 1 here, yeah, then it becomes factorial. So in alpha is 1, this turns to the exponential function. Yeah, so this is some interpolation of exponential function. This is a Mittag-Leffler function. I suppose this was not Mittag-Leffler who found this formula. Mittag-Leffler has written various papers on this function, but not in connection with fractional calculus, as far as I know. But anyway, so this is the starting point. Now, what we are going to speak about in general in this second part of the talk directly here. So first of all, here we have usual fractional derivative, and we'd like to look here at the mixed fractional derivative. So in other case, this general fractional operator, which we considered. Yeah. So this is one point of extension. And second point of extension here is this lambda. Lambda is a number. But when we are talking about partial differential equation, here instead of lambda will be operator. So again, what is, say, fractional, basic fractional diffusion equation? Fractional basic diffusion equation will be, if instead of lambda, we'll be have here Laplace operator with respect to some other variable. So function depends on two variables, one kind of time, here it is x, a bit unnaturally, yeah? And another some variable, special variable. So here should be operator acting on function f as a function of the second variable. So if this operator is Laplacian, then we have fractional diffusion, but it can be Laplacian in some power, it can be some other operator. There is a big variety of operator which can appear here. And let us see whether one can directly apply the theory for operator. You see, if lambda is operator, then we have here a series. Now, series is not well-defined for unbounded operator. If operator is bounded, then fine, it's all the same story if it's a bounded operator. But if it is unbounded, that we cannot define it in this way. This is similar with exponent, yeah, this E in power, the semigroup generated by operator. If operator is bounded, then exponent is just the sum, converging sum of the powers, yeah, usual exponential series. But if operator is unbounded, the exponent should be defined in other way, using this functional calculus. And this was in fact a long-standing problem, yeah? How to define this Mittag-Leffler function for operators, yeah? So for unbounded object. And there were many ways of doing this. One of the well-known way was due to, I suppose, Meinardi. They have introduced here some kind of operator integral via the resolvent. The way which I consider the most natural and the most useful in this case was the formula which I discovered quite occasionally in the book of Zolotarev about stable distribution. This is integral representation of the Mittag-Leffler function, where Mittag-Leffler function is represented as the Laplace transform of some positive function. So once it is represented the Laplace transform, only everything we need is just the exponent. And that's what we will see just a bit in more detail on this session. Okay, so now also another very natural extension, well, put lambda, there should be some non-homogeneous term here. And if we consider this as a, with a boundary value at the left, so one of the way, which is very often used, as I say, the standard trick in the theory of partial differential equation, instead of boundary value problem, we'd like to get a problem which has zero on the boundary. And in fact, in this particular fractional case, it is the most convenient way of dealing with this integral. Just by shifting the function, you see, instead of f, we define u f minus y. Yeah, we turn this problem with some boundary problem, yeah, so with Caputo derivative kind, to the problem with Riemann-Liouville derivative. Riemann-Liouville in the sense that the function is zero at A, and we consider also zero to the left. So in this version, it's most natural to study this equation. This is the easiest way to obtain direct formula for the solution of this thing, yeah, by shifting we get the equation which is zero outside the domain which we are looking at. Now we can find the solution. Remember our language, which we introduced previously, yeah, allows us to write this formula more or less straightforwardly. Yeah? So what is the solution after all? Yeah? What is this? This is operator minus lambda in power minus one. So f should be obtained as a resolvent applied to this function. That's what we're writing here, resolvent. And for the resolvent, again, we have explicit formula, resolvent, this resolvent. This is the integral of exponent, and this is the transition probability of the process, or analytically, this is the fundamental solution of this operator, as already mentioned, yeah? Fundamental solution, well, this is actually fundamental solution of the Cauchy problem for this operator. But anyway, this is standard formula to write a resolvent in terms of the semigroup. Now, if we write this, we can just a bit cleaning here, and this is the way we can present it. You see, so directly, we have the formula. What I'm saying, we can forget about everything. We have explicit formula directly, just because we introduce these three languages. They give us solution. To the very general equation, we have directly solution. And why is it a good solution? Well, because this is integral expression. Integral always good, no singularity anymore. Integral. Yeah? So the only thing which is a bit unpleasant here is the lambda. You see, I talked that we like to, instead of lambda, we like to put an operator. Can we do? Yes, here we can put, yeah, because this is just semigroup. But this will be a bit unpleasant thing. But in fact, we can get rid of this lambda, making integration by parts. Instead of the derivative here, derivative with this, we can transfer the derivative to the another, to the second half, and it can be written in this way. So this is the most nice way. So the solution is written in terms of the integrals. And instead of lambda, you know, you can put an operator because it's a semigroup. Once operator generalizes, define the semigroup, we can write the solution of the fractional differential equation. Now this object, what it is, yeah? This is derivative. This is everything fine with this because this function is monotone with respect to time t. This is the effect of this monotone process. And process is monotone, it moves in one direction. Yeah, this function, which is the green function of the Cauchy problem or transition probability for the corresponding process, it is monotone with respect to t. And therefore this derivative is defined, if not pointwise, but at least in the generalized sense as a measure. So everything here is nicely defined, and in fact we have the formula. So in a sense, one can stop on it, yeah? We have explicit solution in terms of the integral. Yeah, we can now do the simulation, Monte Carlo, whatever like. But of course, we can look a bit further and to give to this expression some other forms and giving a bit more insight into this problem. Yeah. But already, as I say, already for the classical derivative, yeah, we have formula which is not given in terms of some power series. It is a formula which is given in terms of the exponent. Okay, so here we can define now the generalized function. Remember, Mittag-Leffler function is actually the solution of the linear problem. So in order to get the solution of the linear problem, yeah, so this is a solution of the linear problem. Yeah, we have to define the Mittag-Leffler function generalized in this way. So it is also now Laplace transform of some positive measure. And we can get the solution in terms of this Mittag-Leffler function, which exactly will directly extend the classical case. I mean, classical case, instead of mu, we have this beta. And now mu is a general mixing measure. This is a formula. Everything is extends, yeah? So this is Mittag-Leffler function, and this is this potential measure, and potential measure is linked with the Mittag-Leffler function via this formula. So we can say that everything is expressed in terms of Mittag-Leffler function, or everything is expressed in terms of potential measure. Okay, so now we can, already everything is ready. I more or less said everything, yeah? Instead of lambda, we can put an operator. So now this thing is already generalized diffusion fractional, generalized in which sense? Well, we have here general derivative on the left. And here, in fact, operator A, which is not necessarily a Laplace or diffusion or even Laplace in some power. This is, in fact, anything, yeah, which generates you a group, a semigroup. Yeah? So anything. So whenever you can solve this equation with usual derivative, the formula which we developed solve you, gives you automatically the solution for the case when the derivative on the left-hand side is not the usual, but this mixed fractional generalized thing. Yeah. So again, we turn this problem with the boundary value problem, we turn it to the problem with the Riemann-Liouville type with zero on the left. And this is the most natural way to deal with this thing. Now, I present the formula for the case when A is, this is the simplest thing, when E in power TA is a contraction. You see why this is important, because in this formula, you see we have this E minus lambda T. This is well defined when operator A instead of minus lambda is a contraction operator. So if it is contraction, a contraction, it always contraction when we talk about the generators of Markov processes, all this Feller generator, they are, so this being contraction is equivalent to saying lambda positive. So in this case, this formula defines you this Mittag-Leffler function. Well, this is the definition which is correct. Yeah, it's well defined for all A generating the same because this is less than one and because this is also well defined. Now we can ask the question whether we can extend it to the case when A is not necessarily contraction, yeah, just any semigroup here. And this theory can be defined. I will not give here details. They are in the papers which I refer to. Yeah, so whenever you have here bounded semigroup, yeah, with some growth, yeah. You can define it, but there can be some already restriction on this new. Yeah, so not for any new, this object will be well defined if A is not contraction. Effectively, we introduced with you this comparison principle. So in fact, is measure new is bounded below by something like stable Levy measure, then this will be defined for all A now. Otherwise, we can have the situation which is defined just for fractional operator, for contraction. For operator A, which defines the contraction semigroup. Well, this is somehow the theorem. Yeah? So, if you have semigroup of contraction in Banach space, that's what I said, just here written in a bit more formal way, then this potential measure of this semigroup is well defined. Now, semigroup, we here consider, you see this combined semigroup. So, this is semigroup acting on one variable, yeah, and this is semigroup acting on another variable. They commute, yeah, because they are acting on different variables. So their product is also a semigroup. And this semigroup is well defined on this space. You see now the space is functional space of function with value in Banach space B defined on the interval AB. So it is well defined as a sigma finite measure, and this is the formula which gives you the solution to the linear equation I have written again, sort of a very general case. As a remark here, again, to other developments which are not really developed here, we can consider the situation, well, possibly I mention it a bit later, but we can consider, in fact, the situation when this A itself depends on X. Then this is not so simple. So then, but there is another development based on operator value non-commutative Feynman-Katz formula, very interesting story. This is different a bit, yeah? More complicated, but also can be done, yeah? So in what I'm writing here, operator A does not depend on time, yeah? So we have here diffusion operator with coefficients not depending on time. If they do depend, then another thing, yeah? Then this also not so well-defined thing as a product, yeah? They are all mixed up in one process. So, but this is different story, which I'm not touching here. Yeah, so that's what I have written here in the slide, yeah, I forgot. Yeah, this is more general case. Operator A dependent here, remember X is time here. So this is diffusion operator depending on time. So time, non-homogeneous Markov process. And again, also this mixed derivative, they also can depend, say, on special coordinates. So this is more complicated case. We're not talking about it, though many things is done in this direction. This is just beyond the time of my talk. But now sort of basic examples. So one of the famous story is fractional Schrodinger equation. I suppose it was written about something 20 years ago somewhere first. And the people who have written this thing, they were very proud. They have written, we discovered the new fractional quantum mechanics. So very serious words about discovery, meaning that we write for the Schrodinger equation instead of usual derivative. On the left, we write fractional derivative. Okay, of course, we can say that we discover the fractional quantum mechanics, yeah, but it's nonetheless just writing fractional derivative instead of the usual one. So, how deeply this is actually developed and rooted in the quantum mechanics, this I still do not know. Possibly this is not the main point of the application of fractional calculus, which is much more natural. But nevertheless, there are quite a lot of, and it's very nice mathematics, and there is quite a lot of paper. They are still continue to be published on various cases of well-posedness of this equation, which from my general construction, they're just straightforward application. Yeah, but from the physical point of view, more interesting is fractional elasticity, of course. Yeah, so continuum in statistical mechanics. I'm not saying that's not natural for quantum mechanics, but just possibly I just less know about this application. Yeah, so we can take, as I say here on the right, we can take, say, arbitrary pseudo-differential operators, yeah? And if it is not depending on position, yeah, so it's sort of homogeneous, then we can get explicit formula, okay, this integrals, not very important for you now to see all the details, but it's explicit integral formula, which we can obtain here for the solution in this case. Now let's look at this from the probabilistic point of view. Remember, in my title was probabilistic, and now I talk quite a lot about just analytical side, yeah? Because as I mentioned, it was my point also to be accessible, at least in some parts, not to specialists in probability. And here really insights and good understanding of probability is important, because we're talking about martingales and roses and so on. So what I'm saying, that the same formula, the same as for the integrals, yeah, we can derive this integral probabilistically. The same way we can derive these solutions, which we derived analytically, we can derive them probabilistically. For this, we need this Dynkin again martingale, yeah? So if we have process, feather process generated by some operator, then this formula define your Dynkin martingale. Yes, martingale means that the expectation of the sink is zero. Expectation is zero means that the expectation of this function can be written in terms of this right-hand side. And this allowed you to give the formula. So this is a Dynkin formula, which allows you to find the function f of x from its boundary condition. This is a general formula. But since we have now, you see our Caputo, Jabarshan derivative and Riemann-Liouville derivatives, they are all just generators of process. So for them, this just explicit formula is applied. If we apply this formula, then we again get the formula which were written previously, but from the point of view, they can be looked a bit differently, but that they are the same. Yeah, if we applying this Dynkin-Martingale, then the solution for the equation now, this is written for y equals zero, just to I remember y is the initial condition. Yeah? Just to make a bit shorter. So that's the solution of the linear equation with initial condition zero. So this is expectation. And again, this is a process generated by this operator. And this tau xa, this is time of exit of the process starting from x. And this is the time of exiting from a. So this is explicit solution written in terms of the path integral. So probabilistically, yeah? So expectation means expectation with respect to all possible paths, yeah? So it's infinite dimensional path integral, which gives us the solution of this linear process, of this linear equation. And this allows us to give more insight in what is meant by the Mittag-Leffler function. Well, you see this Mittag-Leffler function, which I have written previously, not such a bad thing, integral e minus lambda, and then some derivative. Yeah, so it's explicit formula, yeah? But if we look at it probabilistically, now we can rewrite this formula using this probabilistic representation. And then what we obtain, remarkable thing, in fact, yeah? When I first derived it myself, I was quite surprised, yeah? That this formula, this Mittag-Leffler function, is nothing else as the Laplace transform of the time of exit of the process. This is fantastic, yeah? And strangely, that this formula really was not used, you know, for, you know, 20, 40 years ago, yeah? This formula for the usual fractional derivative, well, again, at least, you know, 30 years, no, quite well, at least it's long ago well known, but possibly not well known to people working in fractional calculus. So if you have this for the usual derivative, then it is known. Now if we use it for this generalized derivative, then this is my formula. Yeah? So this fractional generalized Mittag-Leffler function, which introduced as an integral, is nothing else as the Laplace transform of this exit time. So that this integral, which we have there on the right in the formula, this is nothing else but the density of the probability distribution of this exit time. Yeah, so that this remarkable, very general formula. Yeah? And it tells, of course, that this Mittag-Leffler function, for example, is completely monotone. Again, something known, yeah, but somehow not well advertised, I think, in the community. Yeah? I even remember that there's a book, fundamental book of three German, René Schilling, some other people, Bernstein functions, yeah? They introduced 100 to 200 examples of this Bernstein function, but Mittag-Leffler function was not there, strangely enough. This is a remarkable, most important example of this Laplace transform of positive measures. Okay, so yes, this is what we get for the classical Mittag-Leffler function. We can express it now, you see, not as a sum, yeah, but really as something very nicely defined, expectation. You can calculate it. You do not need any series here. Series is also good, yeah, but this is integral representation, also with somehow probabilistic meaning. Mittag-Leffler function is just expectation, it's just Laplace transform of the exit time of the stable Levy process. And now we can also write the expression for the solution in this form. Yeah, remember it was written in terms of Mittag-Leffler function. Now we can write it directly in terms of the expectation. So this is the expectation of the semi-group generated by A taken at this random time. So again, this is some formula which gives us something again seen and noted by many authors previously, that to get the solution of the fractional equation, if we have the solution of usual equation, we just have to make a random time substitution. Yeah? So we beg the same thing. We have just a random time substitution for the solution. Takes the expectation, and this gives us the solution of fractional equation rather than solution of the initial one. So here, this is formula is given for the fully general case, and therefore it includes the solution of this Hadamard, Kober, Erdei linear equation, and so on and so forth in this remarkably simple form. Okay, so nicely we came to part three. It was not so long as I was afraid. So we can now talk about two-sided and multidimensional problem, yeah, which I already started talking about this two-sided problem, but they are also very much all the processes which I mostly talked about, yeah, was first there was stable Levy motion, then were Levy subordinator. These processes, or also with variable new, all this process, they were monotone. So we have jump on one side permanently. Yeah? But in fact, we can consider the possibility to jump both to the right and to the left. And this gives us, leads us to the theory of two-sided fractional differential equation. If we have fractional derivative on the left of one of the interval, plus a fractional derivative, right derivative, linked to the right end of the interval and all something in the middle. Then we get this two-sided problem. They are much studied actually, yeah. In particular, you can imagine where they appear. They appear in fractional calculus of variation, yeah. And we have this boundary value problem. If you consider fractional Euler equation, then you necessarily get this two-sided fractional equation. But the story, from the point of view which I presented you, probabilistic story, we look at all the story from the same point of view. Yeah, we have generator of a Markov process, therefore generalized fractional integral is just potential operator. And the solution of linear equation, this is expectation of the time of exit, yeah? So that's everything is more or less said, yeah? But we can make it a bit more sort of explicit. Yeah? Well, so first of all, we can define a process. Now you see, we can consider the process which is defined on the interval, or it also can be defined on some more general subset of a real line, collection of several intervals. Yeah, and whenever we are jumping through some boundary point, that we are stopped on the attempt to cross it or kill. Yeah, so there are two versions giving you the extension of Riemann-Liouville or Caputo-Dzhibarshan derivative. So this basically will be the generator here of the process killed on the attempt to cross the boundary. Yeah? So once we're coming outside the boundary, we're killed. Yeah? So this will be the rate of killing. Yeah. Well, this is somehow our explicit formula. So for each x, yeah, we can define this right and left bounds for the integral. But as I say, there can be several intervals now considered together, one process living in this separate intervals. So one of the, as I mentioned, basic case, this is two-sided problem. Yeah. And so this is Caputo fractional differential equation. We are now living on the interval AB. We have left-hand side given, right-hand side given. And we have here left derivative and right derivative. Yeah, so this is written with some number lambda, but again, it can be extended Banach value. There can be an operator, say diffusion operator here. So in general, we have, you see, so this is written classical beta fractional derivative, but it can include all this, you know, mixed thing, yeah, which are considered also in the literature. And we consider very general, in fact, case, just the operator, which is with the increments, which are weighted with respect to some weighting measure. And well, the same formula more or less apply here. So we have here linear term. So this is the main thing. And well, this is more or less the same formula. Suppose, yeah, that's what I want to say, that we can define here two-sided fractional integral as inverse as a potential operator, inverse operator to the operator defining this process. So now our operator is the sum of these two things, yeah, or general sum operator of first order applied to function f. And again, the formula, the same formula with the expectation here works. Now multi-dimensional extension. Well, as I mentioned, multi-dimensional, what is multi-dimensional? Again, we have, you see, we can have here arbitrary Markov process. Now I want to consider what happens with this process if we reduce it to some subdomain. Yeah, so if we reduce it to some subdomain, we can to think what happens when we are jumping. When we are jumping inside, then it's fine. We're jumping as usual. But if our jump plans to land somewhere outside, yeah, then we have to stop it on the attempt to cross the boundary. But where does it cross the boundary? Yeah, stochastic analysis does not tell us the trajectory of the jump. Just tell us the jump from here to here. Therefore, there is here some ambiguity. Yeah? But there is, of course, very natural way to say, well, the most natural way that it will go straight. Yeah. So we can see that if we want to jump here, we stopped it as if the path was a straight line. Yeah. But of course, here there are possibility to make it in a different way. Also, for example, if you try to think about this extension for manifolds, yeah, then we can here, instead of straight line, we say can think about geodesics. They may not be well defined uniquely. So there are some details that appear here in a multidimensional case. But so to say, for Euclidean space, is possibly very natural case to consider the jumps as straight line, and therefore stopping here on the straight line intersecting the boundary. So we introduce arbitrary now operator. So this is arbitrary operator of order not exceeding one. Yeah, I call this is fully mixed in all possible way. So not exceeding one means precisely this condition, yeah, which is condition on nu to be called Levy kernel. Yeah, so this is Levy kernel. Well, this sub in X saying that this is uniformly sort of Levy kernel. Yeah, in principle, we can consider when this holds for any X. Here we use it sub of all X is uniformly bounded. So this operator I call operator of fractional, mixed fractional order, not exceeding one. So here included both right and left derivative in various combination and also derivative of first order. So to this operator, we can apply this procedure. You see this formula, what is written here, yeah? Please not be very much confused with this formula, but what is written here is precisely this thing, yeah? So if you want jump from here to here, yeah, then we are stopped at this point. So that's what is encoded in this a bit lengthy formula. So for any y, yeah, we define the ray which comes from this point outside, and when it's stopped on the boundary, then we will stop all jumps jumps which are going to cross the thing. Yeah, and therefore we obtain the the operator, which can be considered as a very natural multidimensional extension, Caputo type boundary condition, Caputo-Jabarshan boundary type condition. So it's now operator already on the domain. And you see this RDXY, this is precisely which I already have written, yeah? For any XY, this is this point. Whenever we want to jump outside, we are turned back to the boundary by this operator. Okay, so with this formula, you can define, everything again, yeah? So, of course, there are more now complicated questions about when the process is well defined and so on. And here, certain, of course, properties of the boundary are important to introduce. So some details appears. But if the boundary is sort of smooth and convex, then there is no question that everything is well defined for smooth convex boundary. And we can consider some basic examples when the boundary is hyperplane or ball or sphere, something like that, and then we can do some calculations. So these are explicit formula. If D is a half space, yeah, so one coordinate is less than some number, another is arbitrary, then this RD have this explicit expression. And the operator, therefore, AD star, D star means this Caputo-Jabarshan also has this explicit expression. Okay, well, a bit complicated, yeah, but well, that's how it is. And it's not, after all, so complicated. Yeah. There's another situation when D is a bend. Yeah. So first coordinate it is between two given numbers. X2 is arbitrary. Again, we can explicitly calculate the corresponding operator, which is obtained, which defines as the process, which is obtained from the initial one by interrupting the attempt to cross the boundary. Yeah? So here we have this, what is this? Yeah. So we had this operator A. Remember, this is our operator, initial operator A of this kind. Now this operator defines as the process in RD. Now instead of this process, we consider the process inside the bend, yeah? Such that whenever it tried to jump here, it lands here. And now we can just explicitly calculate the corresponding generator. Well, that's how it looks like. Yeah, so this is also the moment worth stressing. If we consider a Brownian motion, yes, and enforce it to stay in some domain, then generator is not changed. Generator remains the same. This is a property of locality. The Brownian motion, when it turns around inside the domain, it does not feel the boundary. It feels the boundary once it touches it. Yeah, so only boundary behavior should be expressed, explicitly made when we're talking about the Brownian motion on any local operator on diffusion in some domain. But if our process is not local with jumps, then whenever we introduce anything on the boundary, then the generator is changed directly. Yeah, there's much more complicated change here involved. Yeah, no, it's not just the boundary condition, it's really the whole behavior is affected once we introduce the boundary. Just because the boundary can be reached in 1 second, yeah, not 1 second, in one moment, instantaneously it can be reached, yeah? Unlike the Brownian motion, which has to continuously kind of reach it. Yeah? So these are generalized Caputo-Jabarshan derivative for the case of the domain which forms a bend. Now, if we have a unit ball, again, we can calculate the explicit expression. Okay, you do not have to really go through this formula directly. Yeah, it takes some time to digest it, but anyway, we have again the explicit formula for this. Now, another point which I wanted to mention is about beta more than one. So in everything which I told previously, we talked about the mixed derivative of order not exceeding one. So what if in more than one? Yeah, and in fact, we do not have to think much more above two. Yeah, because we know from the probability that in fact first and second order operators have relations to probability. Yeah? So if we want to stay somehow inside of the probabilistic interpretation, then we have to think about this mixed derivative of order up to two, not above really. Yeah? So, but we talked only above, only for the derivative of the order up to one. So what if they are between one and two? So to see what's going on here, well, let us rewrite the Riemann-Liouville derivative. Now this is case bit one and two. And this is Caputo-Djibarchin derivative. So we can, you know, previously we realized that for bit between zero and one, we've seen that this a derivative, which this operator generates processes. If we're looking at these formulas, well, if we are probabilists, then we see what's wrong, what's not wrong here. Yeah? Is this operator a generator of some process? Is there anything wrong with this formula from the probabilistic point of view? And you'll see nothing is wrong. Yeah, this is very well in the style of this Levy-Hinchin formula. Yeah, so these things have a very natural probabilistic interpretation. And in fact, as previously, this really tells us that we have a process skilled on the attempt to cross the boundary. But if we look at the derivative of this Caputo-Djibarchin time, then here appears this guy. This is not something which you can see in the generator of a Feller process. So we have this breaking of this link, operator and probabilistic representation. This cannot appear in the formula for the generator of a Feller process. But this is nothing specifically wrong. In fact, this term is somehow, so to say, unpleasant singularity, which can be nicely subtracted.
Yes, Vasily, we have a question. May I ask a question? Yeah, so that's from Julia. In the first problem, is it possible to consider not observing but reflecting barrier or the barrier that pushes up the process?
Well, reflecting is different. It gives us, we can consider reflecting barrier, of course, yeah? Well, this gives us some other type of derivative. This is not the one which is naturally be associated with Caputo-Djibarchin term. This will be just some other thing. But again, when we're talking about, you see, this is a subtle thing, because when we're talking about reflection for this jump type processes, but again, there are many possibilities how to define this reflection. Yeah. So if we start drawing pictures, yeah. So the process want to jump here, yeah. How we can consider reflection? Yeah. It's not at all clear how it should be reflected. You don't know where it goes. So I mean there is quite a lot of possibilities here to define generalized reflection. And this is very interesting point, and it's very interesting point for me, and specifically from the point of view of duality. Yeah? This is something which is another very nice topic which I like. Duality between process, and this duality on the level of the Brownian motion tells us that reflected Brownian motion is dual to absorbing Brownian motion. So if we consider this absorbed process like Caputo-Djibarchin type, then dual to this should be reflected in some sense. Yeah. But exact sense is not sort of understood by me yet. So this is something which I really would like to understand. If we consider now dual to the thing, yeah, what kind of reflection we should obtain here? So this is interesting question, in fact, to explore, and specifically from the point of view of duality. Okay, but anyway, these are different operators. And you see again, the absorption. And from the absorption, we can consider different things. We can absorption, we can say, well, then it is stopped here, or we can allow him to go afterwards backwards. So there are several possibilities, but from the point of view of the boundary value problem, it's not so important. We just stopped here once we consider the boundary value problem for absorption, absorbing case. Yeah. And for reflecting, this is all well, I cannot say, as I say, nothing very serious about it, but this is very important thing to explore further. So now what I wanted to say to finish with this beta 1/2, this is that the now this Caputo-Djibarchin derivative, yeah, can be obtained from the Riemann-Liouville minus this thing, this is killing term, and minus this thing, which really takes us out of the generator of Fowler process. This is not something which can be inside the generator of Levy process. So, but very naturally to regularize the thing. Yeah? If we take the separator and subtract the thing, yeah, then we'll get regularized Caputo-Jabarshan derivative of order between one and two. Well, so here it is written, well, just a bit more general case. Now that interruption, well, really means this subtraction of this term. So this is a general form of Riemann-Liouville derivative, and this is general form of Caputo-Jabarshan derivative. So now let's see that this term is somehow really wrong. It's really it introduces unnecessary irregularity, so to say. Yeah. So to see this, yeah, we can observe that if function is twice continuously differentiable, so that's the normal function which we can expect to be here inside the generator. And then up to terms tending to zero, this Riemann-Liouville behaves like that. It means then when x state to a, this thing goes to infinity. Okay, so it goes to infinity if f prime of a is not zero. So you see, so this term, if we take the solution is bounded only in the situation when this thing is zero. So when it is zero, then they become equal. Yeah, so this term should be taken out of the operator, and this defines as what I call regularized fractional Caputo-Jabarshan derivative of order from one to two. Only with this regularization, we can get a reasonable statement of the boundary value problem. Okay, so this is Riemann-Liouville derivative. There is no problem with this, as I said, because here everything is well defined and the process killed on the crossing the boundary is well defined. Okay, so this is again general setting. Now we can consider arbitrary operator, not necessarily independent on x with weights, just there is standard condition for this measure nu to be Levy measure. We can construct corresponding process, extend it in this way, and that's the point. Main term of asymptotics, yeah, is this thing when x tends to a. And this is unbounded unless the derivative fa is not zero. Okay, therefore the analog of the Caputo fractional derivative, that's what I say, is subtraction. We take this unnatural kind of thing and subtract the singularity. Then we obtain operator which with well-defined properties. And what is nice here is that actually that the solution, let me just skip a bit here. What I want to say is actually the necessary condition for the solution is that this derivative is zero. And therefore it is irrelevant whether we in this case consider this regularized or not regularized case. Yeah. So they both as give the same solution for the boundary value problem. Yeah. What else I wanted to say? Well, example of L-post, let me skip it. Our time is approaching to the end. I want to show that there is example of explicit solution. Very interesting. This is solution for the case, I suppose it's possibly unique example of explicit solution for the two-sided problem. Yeah, interval minus one, one, symmetric two-sided fractional derivative corresponding to some process. And in this case, we can calculate everything explicitly in this formula. This is general formula with this exit time. Yeah, I mean, I'm a bit quick here. I'm skipping, of course, time is approaching. But anyway, here everything is explicit. And another explicit solution is, thank you, there is another explicit solution with actually with the ball. If you have equation in the n-dimensional ball, that also has, we can write this
solution in explicit way. Well, rather complicated, but anyway. So there are examples, of course, very rare when this multidimensional problem can be solved explicitly. Okay, so now I'm really finishing. Thank you. I'm not hearing you, Elena.
Yeah. So thank you very much. And yes, we can, well, we can see people clapping. They're still muted. So if you want to ask a question, please unmute yourself and ask a question. Yeah, so people are writing in the chat. So, well, you can unmute and ask also. Yeah, so from Akash, the question is, can we associate fractional Brownian motion or SDE driven by FEM with solution of some kind of PDE via Feynman-Katz type formula?
Well, I suppose there's a whole course of Professor Mishura is about this fractional Brownian motion. So I think it's just, but it's a serious deep question, yeah? But I actually refer to the lectures of Professor Mishura because, you know, this is a special thing, linking with fractional process, yeah? This is a special topic in itself, yeah? So it's not something which directly link, let's say, with what I'm talking about. There are this link, yeah? There are this link because we know, and again, it will be shown somewhere in the lectures, yeah? That the fractional Brownian motion can be written as a fractional integral. Yeah? Okay, so this links exist, definitely, yeah? It's not very straightforward formula, but it exists. Therefore, just fractional process, they are written in terms of this fractional integral. So that's the connection, yeah? And therefore, the solution of fractional SDE can be written in this way. Yeah? But this is different topic, so to say. Yeah? This is really topic about fractional processes. It's a special thing. It is not one sense, not in one sentence to answer this properly. The Feynman-Katz formula, which I told about, is an operator value Feynman-Katz formula for solving just this fractional differential equation. Of course, they are linked with the process, but not fractional process. These are processes which are stopped on the attempt to cross the boundary. They can be expressed in terms of this operator valued Feynman-Katz formulas.
Well, thank you very much. Any other questions? Yeah, if you want to ask a question, please unmute yourself and ask a question. So people are just writing thanks a lot, and you know, there are lots of thank yous for
Very nice to hear it. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah, so if this is it, then I think we'll stop here. Well, I don't know if you do you have any time if you well we can say that people who want to talk more informally can stay and talk for a little bit. There is no exercise session today, so this is it for today. We will restart tomorrow at 10 a.m. London time.
Okay, thank you everybody. Bye-bye, and thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for today.